The pandemic has highlighted our strengths and our weaknesses. But if we've beaten the virus so far, it's been at a high cost. The number of people on a benefit is way up, and with the wage subsidy due to end next month, more could follow. So how do we treat those in need? Just 6 weeks out from the election, has the government done enough? Tania Page takes us back to her part of New Zealand and opens a window to a world normally unseen.
Northland's beauty belies a sad truth. It's one of the poorest parts of the country. It's where I'm from, but this is a difficult trip for me.
So you've got quite a few to deliver today then?
Yep.
In Whangaroa, an hour from Kaitaia.
Just blankets?
And clothing. Clothing for a young girl and for one of our kaumātua.
Okay. So we best be on our way, eh?
Bye.
I'm on the road with an iwi rep, Karen, to find out who needs what.
It started through us distributing kai for our kaumātua and queer and our vulnerable whānau over COVID.
But the need was there before COVID.
Yep, the need was there well before COVID.
By reaching out during lockdown, they shone a light on the standard of housing.
Did you know how some of them were living?
No, not really, but until you actually go into their home and you see the struggles.
We're visiting a 69-year-old kaumātua who we can't identify. He lives alone.
And how long has he been living here?
A few years. His parents lived here.
He was sleeping in this caravan before moving into the house during lockdown.
Kia ora, matua. We've just brought you a few things.
Karen runs through a basic assessment of the house.
So is your home warm?
No, it's not.
No. So your roof is leaking over there?
Oh, leaking bad. All around the thing is all leaking.
He's got a toilet, but...
How do you shower?
In a bucket.
In a bucket?
Yeah.
How do you get hot water?
I boil it.
He had a hip replacement a few years back and a stroke.
So is it hard to get around here? Because the floors are a little bit uneven.
Most of those rips, seeing the carpet then, they come from me dragging my leg.
Would you say you need help?
Well, I went to the doctor when I was 2 weeks back, and they arranged for a caregiver, but I haven't heard anything, so I'm just waiting. So, oh well, you know, it's lucky I've got my gardens.
Your gardens keep you busy.
Well, they keep me fed.
COVID-19 has brought a ray of hope.
I got a fright when everybody started turning up. Karen came flying around. Wow, man. Well, that did boost me up. Yeah, so I was happy with that visit.
To know someone cares.
Yeah. I don't ask people for anything. I don't, you know. I don't ask anyone for anything.
Just up the road, the same iwi, Ngāti Kahu Ki Whangaroa, is welcoming new staff at its transitional housing centre, where campers once pitched tents, desperate families now peg their dreams on finding a home.
It's definitely been difficult, but you don't have a choice. You just get on with it, you do what you can.
This mum of four, who we're calling Sarah, is bravely speaking out.
I was married for 10 years. We had 4 kids. We split up. It was really abrupt. There was not really any warning to it.
That was 2 years ago.
We drove up north with what fitted in our car.
From Auckland to this house on her family's property.
Definitely not a permanent solution. No one had lived in it for years. The property itself was too far away from the power lines to ever be connected. There was no bathroom whatsoever. There was a long drop outside, but it was a house, it was a roof, it was dry, and it was somewhere that wasn't my car.
This is the driveway after rain.
This is what happens in every single time in winter. Lord.
I explained to the kids that we were camping. This was fun.
Now it's the baby. I was third, the baby's last.
I tried to turn what was hard work into fun. I was just grateful for everything that I did have. People that were so supportive. I was really happy to be there.
And at the transitional housing centre...
Is it nice to be in a place with a nice working stove?
Yeah, well, my seven-year-old just asked me, actually, where's the flame? I'm telling him it's an electric oven, so there's no flame.
Did you ever think there was a time you'd actually be grateful for cooking on a stove?
No. You definitely take those things for granted.
Sarah's on a benefit now for the first time in her life.
Is the benefit enough?
No, I don't think anyone says that the benefit's enough.
What were some of the choices you had to make over what you spent your money on?
It was, am I going to feed them healthy food or keep them warm? Once you've dialed it down and you've cut everything back, all that's left to take money from when you need something is your food bill. So that's what goes.
Her ex-husband is paying child support.
Do you remember the Goosebumps movie?
Sarah's on the long waiting list for a state house.
How would you describe the system to someone who's never been in it?
Not what you would expect from a country like New Zealand. Everything's supposed to be... Sorry.
Poverty is morally wrong, in my view. When we organise a system that deliberately holds people in poverty, that's wrong.
Cindy Kiro.
I'm the kind of person who has taken on a lot of difficult issues for rather powerless groups.
A former children's commissioner.
Honestly, I don't have all the solutions, but I've got some ideas.
Pro Vice Chancellor Māori at Auckland University.
Tomorrow there'll be another All-Star Forum.
And chair of the government's Welfare Expert Advisory Group.
Well, do you think the government's done enough to address poverty, inequality and housing?
No. Whoever comes into government will need to address the fundamental inequalities that exist. New Zealand still believes that it's a place where people are equal. Poverty is evidence that that's not the case. Can you imagine what it means if your income is $100 or $50 short a week to meet basic food costs, to pay for clothing, to pay for your power? That is the reality that, you know, over a quarter of a million New Zealanders are facing, and it's increasing as a result of COVID.
Some people think poverty is a result of bad choices.
It's really critical that people realise that these are not choices that people necessarily make. They are the result, often, of unexpected events in people's lives. The loss of a job, the loss of a relationship. What do we do collectively to help people during times of unexpected crisis and disaster?
Coming up.
It's good, Gaffa.
She got it. Yeah.
Is it good news?
Yes.
Small successes on the front line of poverty. And...
It's not just about handouts from the government.
Communities helping themselves.
So what's the need for this kind of material around here?
Well, it's huge.
Cindy Kiro is a voice for the voiceless. To her, poverty and inequality are personal.
We had almost nothing growing up, and very little food. You never quite knew where the next meal was coming from. So I know what it's like to live in that place.
Born in Whangarei, raised in Auckland, driven to help others.
Poverty is morally wrong, in my view. And in a country that is reasonably well off, we have an obligation and an opportunity to address that. During the 80s and 90s, we saw the most rapid rise in inequality.
They can come on TV tonight and tell you that your milk's up to 20 cents, and what will people say?
We created a so-called welfare system which was highly targeted, highly conditional, which we now still have. We have communities that have really been deprived of any investment.
Communities like the one I grew up in, Moirua. When I was a kid, the only time this Northland town hit the news was for job losses or gang fights.
Oh my goodness, look at you. So good to see you again.
Ngaho Davis has been trying to change that narrative for 40 years as a social worker and community advocate.
This is where I waited for the bus every morning for school.
And they still run the buses from here to Pakaraka and another school in Kaikui.
State Highway 1 is busy, and the town was too. A post office, a bank, but then the 80s.
From that really bustling community to where we have now, and a lot of that had nothing to do with the people but economic policy at the time. Neoliberal economic policies coming out from Rogernomics actually decimated rural New Zealand.
Cutbacks and closures.
Also the advent of technology, and you didn't need so many people, you know, working in those jobs. If you travel the middle of the island, going up number one, you will see many towns exactly like Moirua.
He helped set up this community enterprise. It's been busy.
The government has given us some support to be able to actually bring them up to safety standards.
Fixing up houses.
So what's the need for this kind of material around here?
Well, it's huge. A lot of the whānau that actually come to us are houses with leaky roofs. They got young children with a lot of respiratory issues. So it's not a do-up, it's around essential repairs. Any profits that we make from these community enterprises, they're ploughed back into the community. So it's not just about handouts from the government. This is about us using our own initiatives and resources to be able to do some of the stuff we're doing.
That's also the attitude at Auckland Action Against Poverty.
Come in and have a seat.
Where the office chat...
They're living in their car.
..is a little different.
We popped in there yesterday and he has no food.
Agnes Mangelia is one of the volunteers helping people who can't make ends meet.
We also have people that are working with family that come in here for help.
In fact, almost half of the Kiwi kids living below the poverty line are in working households.
I know how hard it is. We've been there. We know how hard it is. When was the last time you tried to apply for a food grant? She's been trying to get assistance for the last 2 to 3 weeks. And she has been getting declined from her office, from her one's office. So she's after a food grant. She's got 3 babies.
Why was she declined?
They say to her that the money that she's receiving already is enough for her to live on.
Agnes calls and writes to Work and Income.
This has become overwhelming.
Then they wait.
We have a lot of whānau coming in from Wellington, Taupo, Tauranga, so it's not just Auckland. The amount of people that we get in here every day is a clear indicator that the benefit level's not enough.
Back inside, Wins is on the phone about the food grant.
Have a blessed day. Thank you. Okay, bye-bye. It's good, Gaffa. She got it. Yeah.
Is it good news?
Yes.
Cool.
Yes. How about we tell her first before we celebrate?
Yay!
Why are you crying? Oops, sorry. Got it, okay. He's gonna put it in there.
Thank you.
Well, that young mum's just left in tears because she'll be able to feed her kids this morning, and there's already a room full of people waiting for help.
People are not always given their entitlements. You have to sometimes fight for them.
Cindy Kero chaired the government's Welfare Expert Advisory Group.
We heard back from 16,000 New Zealanders. There are some offices where, in fact, it's very supportive, very engaging, very responsive, and there are others where you feel like you're actually a criminal.
They announced their findings last year.
Some things that are absolutely urgent.
We recognised that fundamental change was needed, including inadequate income levels for people who are on benefits.
How inadequate?
Well, anywhere between 20 and 47%.
Few of the working group's 100 recommendations have been adopted by government. But then, a wave of joblessness brought about by COVID.
And that is why we have doubled the winter energy payment. increase main benefit rates by $25 a week, and introduce the COVID income relief payment.
That COVID relief payment, $490 a week, compares to just $250 on the job seeker benefit.
So if you weren't working before the COVID, you still get the minimum, the basic benefit level, but if you'd lost your job due to the COVID, you get more.
Is that fair?
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
I think it raises serious questions about the relativity between the two.
If it was enough for them to live on, they would have just let them apply for the normal job seekers benefit, but they didn't. Where's the love in that? Where's the kindness in that?
If main benefits were adequate, we would not see the huge increase in hardship and other supplementary grants.
Those hardship grants, mostly for food, have been increasing over the last 5 years, rocketing up during COVID. Well, the number of people on job seeker benefits stable for years has surged. On top of that, more than 10,000 New Zealanders are receiving the COVID income relief payment, but that'll end later this year.
Remember Sarah? She tried to get a private rental.
You know, solo parent, income support, I wouldn't be my first option if I owned a home either. So, but I've never been looked at, I've never had a call back.
Before finding out about emergency and transitional housing 6 months ago.
I had no idea about what I was entitled to.
Hi. Hi, how are ya?
They're trying to help her get back on her feet.
Hi, I've got a referral for you for budgeting.
Okay. It's not just the house here, it's the support that I'm going to get to move on.
She's driven by one thing.
They're your world, aren't they?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely never a dull moment with poor kids. I love the madness of it. I love the madness.
My home is hurting. So many going without.
What do you want for your kids?
A home. A stable environment. Normal things. Not much. Just pretty much everything I can't give them right now, which... it's difficult, but yeah, not much.
Why should people care?
They should care because their well-being depends on doing this too. And it's not just the fear that they might end up in the situation of requiring government assistance. It's the reality that when we support people who most need help, in fact, we all benefit.
I have a card or pie. Now, Karen has managed to get the kaumātua to sign up to the free bus that Iwi runs to town. And Sarah, the wahine tour, she's had to move on from the transitional housing centre to care for her sick father.